Welcome to my YouTube channel. My name's Dave. Okay, as with yesterday, I've got to bring up the topic again. 2 days to go. February the 20th is a cutoff. We get the boot from YouTube, no monetization. The problem is, even if we get 1,000 subscribers after it, we go back into a new review of the whole channel, and who knows how many months that will take. Please subscribe. Anyone who has subscribed, every number counts. And thank you very, very much again. So now we will move on to the video. Sorry for that interruption, but I've got to do it. And we've only got days to go to get her over the line. So all assistance is very much appreciated. Thanks again. Continuing from the previous video, we were talking about resonances in two-stroke expansion chambers. For that video, we're talking about standing wave resonances with relationship to the gas and how that resonance waves are essentially a background compared to the compression wave and expansion wave that is timed. We'll get into residual sonic wave resonance. Previously, I was talking about the wavelengths and wavelengths fitting into a tube or harmonics of it causing a resonance. One thing I was going to mention I didn't in the previous video was the fact is that the compression wave and the expansion wave that we're working with are not the node and anti-node of any kind of standing wave, okay? So it's not a matter of having a wavelength like this and then having the node or the anti-node arriving at the right time. That is actually an overthought theory that's come from this resonant theory, which is not valid for exhaust. Now, that is essentially all you need to know about the resonances and the natural frequencies of the gas in the exhaust. That the next thing we're going to move on to is another type of resonance, which is similar to this, but it's a destructive resonance. And that destructive resonance is not a part of the actual waveforms that's going through the pipe. That kind of resonance is destructive resonance, where the pipe material actually resonates and vibrates at the natural frequency of the metal. Some of these surfaces, even if they're thin metals, they act a bit like a drum, and they will resonate at the natural frequency of the metal, not of the gas inside. Once the body of that starts vibrating, then obviously that's going to cause thrumming or drumming waves inside the exhaust pipe, which is again, you know, more waves floating around inside there, which will have some effect. The main thing is you don't want vibration from the actual exhaust going back to the cylinder head, because vibration in the combustion chamber is going to rob power. Now the engine's already got a vibration of a certain phase depending on its balance and what's going on with the engine, and then coupled with the resonant vibration of the materials used in the exhaust expansion chamber, we can set up quite a nasty vibration that can be literally destructive. It can break things, and it can break mounts on expansion chambers and exhaust mounts. So what we do to deal with that is, if we have a pipe that's particularly prone to resonant vibration, then we've got to consider the metals we make it out of. We don't want to make it too thin. And the other side of it is the actual mountings at the rear. You know, we can't just weld a tab on the top. We've got to put a reinforcement over the actual body of the expansion chamber. We've got to have the proper rubbers to hook onto. In this case, this is a cart pipe with the perforated baffle inside. I've shown you a couple of videos ago about raising the barrels. I talked about that exhaust. And this one has spring hooks at the front. It has a adjustable length for adjusting the tune length to small degrees, and it has a saddle with springs over the top. It's not solid mounted. For road racing, we had expansion chambers kind of like this, which is a slip arrangement in the center with the springs on the outside holding it together, and an O-ring on the inside in between the split. And the TZ's actually had a number of O-rings actually on the outside, and now the O-rings won't catch fire. It's, you know, or melt, nitrile N70 O-rings will do. And that can be manufactured. You just got to make sure that there's no change of the continuity in the actual pipe in the inside diameter of the pipe. It must remain the same, so there's no area changes, otherwise again we'll get reflections off there. So if you isolate the exhaust pipe off the engine, any resonance of the pipe won't be sent back to the engine, robbing power at the combustion chamber, and likewise any vibration from the engine won't be directly transmitted into the exhaust pipe, exciting a resonant effect in the metal. Okay, so that's destructive resonance, and that's something you actually do have to account for, but it's not like it's not something you actually use in calculations to design the software. You just have to be mindful of it. Okay, and that will do it for today. That was just a short one to cover the mechanical resonance issue and how destructive that can be. But again, the gas resonance, it's just not a valid theory. It's only a background effect, and there's nothing to deal with, so you don't have to get into complexities of that, and that just makes expansion chamber design all that more simple to understand. And so please go back over the videos and watch them, and again, if you've got any questions, hit the comments section and we'll see what we can do. February the 20th is the cutoff. Please subscribe now, it all helps, and I will see you in the next video. Thanks again. Bye for now.